The most basic way to use MATLAB is to just use it as a giant calculator. So if I go to my command window and I just type in basic commands, it can add numbers together, can subtract numbers, we can multiply different numbers with the asterisk sign, we can divide different numbers with the slash, and we can do those type of simple commands like that right in the command window. Or if I have another number, say I can square it using the caret command, I can cube it using the caret command, and do all those very basic functions just like I would do on a calculator. But the power that MATLAB starts to add is not only can we run these commands, but I can save the values that I found. So what I can do is I can assign a value to a variable which I'm allowed to name. So let's just say I want to store in the variable A the value of 25 plus 46, for example. So we see on this line here that I'm saying that A equals 25 plus 46. In MATLAB and most programming languages, whatever is on the left side of your equal sign means that we are assigning whatever is on the right side to whatever is on the left side. So if I press enter here, what I've done is I've stored the value of 71 into a variable that I named A. And now if I type A, it's going to print out 71. And what I can do with this is I can say I want to know what's 3 times A. So it takes 3 and multiplies it by whatever I have stored in the variable that I called A. I can have another variable, let's call it B, that I'm going to store 90. So now, if we look at how the workspace is filling up, I've saved the value 71 to A, I've saved the value of 90 to B. And now if I come back to my command window, I can use those letters, those variable names, just like I would numbers. So I can do A times B. That gives me 71 times 90. A divided by B. A raised to the B is going to give me a very large number there. But I can use the variables just like I can numbers, kind of most simply put. Now, when I'm naming my variables, there's no rule like in algebra. Typically, we only have a single letter for our variables, X or Y or Z. But in MATLAB and most programming languages, I can use words or multiple letters to express my variable name. So I can even have numbers involved, which I'll talk about in a little bit here. But say I have something, a variable called letter, and I store the value 6 to it. Or I have a variable named bottle that I store the number 2. Again, just like before, I can take these variables, which I have 6 and 2 stored to, and I can multiply them just like I would regular numbers there, and I get the value of 12. Now, this is helpful when we get to solving problems, because you might want to give your variables names that are easy to recognize what they're supposed to represent. So bottle could be the number of bottles in something, or letter could mean the number of letters in something. And then when I'm writing my program later, I can easily identify what these variables are meant to represent. Now, where I have to be careful in how I come up with variable names is I can't just choose anything I want. There are some restrictions. So first of all, I can't have a variable start with a number. So if I wanted to call something 1A, it's not going to let me do that. However, I could use A1, and that's okay. So I can have numbers in my variable names as long as it does not start with a number. That's going to be okay. And there's also some variables that are already built into MATLAB that I want to be careful that I don't overwrite. For example, pi, is already stored in MATLAB as the number pi, 3.14159, etc. So pi I would not want to assign a new value to, because then if I try to use it later on, I've written over what the basic value is for pi that has built in. Also, what I don't want to do is assign a built-in function name as a variable. So for example, as you saw previously, I can take the sine of a number. So let's say take the sine of pi. This by default uses radians. Sine is already a built-in function, or I take the sine of pi over 3. But what I don't want to do is say try to assign a number to the word sine, since that's already reserved. So now it thinks that sine is a variable, and now it's not going to understand if I want to take the sine of something, because I've saved it over what was already built in. All right, so you see in our workspace here, I have the things that I've been assigning. I've overwritten the definition of sine that MATLAB wanted to use, so it doesn't understand how to take the sine of a number anymore. So I can undo what I just did. I can clear my workspace, so it's going to forget everything it stored in those variable names. So now it remembers how to use sine because it's not written over. Talking more about the trig functions, it has all of them built in, so cosine, sine, tangent, secant, cotangent, things like that. So they're going to be named as you would expect them to be named. But by default here, if we use sin, cos, if we use secant, sec of pi over 5, these are all going to be taking what we call the argument, or in this case, pi over 5 is the argument we put into the secant function. It wants to take it as a value that's measured in radians. However, if we're working with trig functions and we want to be working in degrees instead, then we can use, instead of sin for sine, I can use sind, and now what the argument it takes, it assumes, is going to be in degrees rather than radians. So notice that if I take sine d of 45 is not the same as sine of 45, because here it thinks the 45 should be in radians, so it does that calculation. With sine d, it gives us the correct value for 45 degrees, 0.7071. And then we can also take inverse functions in a similar way. So I can take arctangent of, let's say, 0.5. I can take arcsine. And here, what I'm seeing is that when I have that argument of 0.4, a sine is going to give me the value back in radians of what the arcsine of 0.4 is going to be. If I use a sine d, it now gives me back the value in degrees rather than radians. So make sure you're careful when using trig functions. Is it a function that's giving you or expecting something in radians, or is it giving you or expecting something that's going to be in degrees? Let's look at some other built-in functions that are in MATLAB here, or if there's a built-in function that you're interested in using, how we can see how it works. Now in this course, I'm not going to have time to tell you about every function that's built into MATLAB. There's thousands or tens of thousands of different functions, but what I do hope that I can give you is the ability to look at how different functions work or look up how they work so that you can use them yourself. So for example, let's say we wanted to know what the log of a number is. So if I type log, which we would think is how you take the log of something, we should expect that if I take the log of 10, how we usually use the term log, it should give me a value of 1. But we see it does not give me a value of 1, it gives me a value of 2.3 as my answer. So we want to see how is log actually working. So I can use that doc function I talked about before and see what does log actually do. And we see that in MATLAB, if I just type log, it's taking the natural log, or what we usually would write out as ln of a number. So it's actually taking the natural log of 10 when I say log. Now I can read through this. It tells me a lot of different information about how I use log. And it also gives me kind of suggestions for similar types of functions that I can use. So we can see here that probably what I was interested in when I wanted to know the log is actually what MATLAB calls log 10. So this takes the 10 log of a number, and that's probably what we were expecting when we just typed in log, like we would do in a calculus course. So here it gives us what we expect. If I type in log 10 of 10, now I get the answer of 1. And we can see, again, back to the help window, all the different things that have to do with log 10, and then similar types of functions here. So if we want the base 2 log of something, we would use log 2.